We'll be right back. Good morning, everyone. We are so glad that you are with us today. We will be celebrating baptisms this Sunday service, and it's always such a special day. We are especially glad that you're with us if you are a family member or a friend of someone who's being baptized today, and we hope that you feel welcome and like there's a whole church pulling for your family member or your friend as they grow in Christ. We are in the middle of a series called Teach Us to Pray, about Jesus' instructions to pray, so you may want to grab your Bible and have that handy for the message part of our service today. And Glenn, we're just so glad that you're with us today. Thanks for joining us.
Christ the Rock. Come on, let's stand to your feet. If you are a guest this morning, we welcome you especially. If you're viewing by live stream, thank you for tuning in. Take a couple of seconds and just greet someone around you. Let them know that you're glad to have them here at Christ the Rock. We're here to praise the name of Jesus. Amen. Oh, 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 oh. And sing for all that my Savior's done for me. Oh, give Him your praise, worship His name. All that I am, sing hallelujah. Forever I'm free, forever I'm changed. Forever my life. Every step, every breath, all that I am, you sing hallelujah. Yeah, yeah. Oh, my whole heart, oh, my soul, let everything within me praise the Lord. Through the shadows, through the storm, let everything within me. Praise the Lord, we praise the Lord, oh, 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 oh. We praise the Lord, oh, oh, oh. Faith is my shield, your word is my sword. The greater the fight, the louder I'll roar. The spirit that raised Him from the grave, living in me. Sing hallelujah. Let's magnify Him. Sing it out. I won't stop singing. of all he's done for me. I won't stop singing of all he's done for me. He heard my cry, set me on a rock, saved me from the hand of the enemy. I won't stop singing about my Savior. Come on, lift your voices.
I won't stop singing of all he's done for me. I won't stop singing of all he's done for me. He heard my cry, set me on a rock, saved me from the hand of the enemy. I won't stop singing about my Savior.
How we doing, church? It's Baptism Sunday, and we're going to have a celebration today. I'm glad you're here. Grab a seat. Let me talk about why we do this here at Christ the Rock. It's a big part of the faith journey to go and get baptized. And so let me tell you why we do this as a church, because a lot of churches, you know, you always wonder, why are we doing this? We're sticking people underwater, and we're bringing them out, and we celebrate. Now, what's that all about? Why is that so special? Well, we get a lot of our direction for this from Jesus Christ, our Lord. And at the end of his life, before he ascended to heaven, he gave some instruction to his disciples, which he also gave to the church. And this is what he said. He said, Matthew 28, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. And here's what he tells us to do then. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And so we take a lot of direction from that. Our mission as a church comes from that. And so our mission is what Jesus told us to do. We make disciples who make disciples like God, like Jesus said, go and do that. And so we still do that today. That's the main focus of what we do. But he also tells us that we should baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, which we'll do in a few minutes. Now, for most people, the faith journey doesn't begin with baptism. It begins when you realize you need Jesus. You realize, like, there's nothing you can do to forgive your own sins, that you got to bring that to the Lord, and you say, Lord, I need you. And you confess that to him, and you invite him into your life as Lord and Savior. Some of you have never done that, and you know you need to do that, to come to Jesus, and you can do that today. Well, and then you get baptized right away if you want to. But that's the start of the journey. And so once you do that, once you've made that inward change. What baptism is it's really the outward expression of the work that God's already been doing in your heart. And so when you go down into the baptism, into the waters of baptism, you're saying, Jesus, I want to be a disciple. I want to make a serious commitment to following you. And that's a choice you make. That's why we don't baptize infants here. So you got to have a relationship with Jesus first. You've got to know him. You've got to be ready to follow him. And so you got to make that choice yourself. So what we do is, when you're ready and you've made that choice, we do full immersion. We want you to get down into the water. We don't just sprinkle a little water on your head. So we drag out this tank so that you can go down into the waters. And what that is it's your old self going down into the water. And then the water washes you clean. That's the symbolism of what Christ did for you. The water washes you clean. And when you come up, a new creation. That's what the Bible says happens. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. And so it's a visual testimony that you are identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's powerful. And so we're gonna get you wet today if you're coming out. So we're excited for that. But baptism also means that you're gonna make a commitment, a deeper commitment to following Jesus as a disciple. So we define a disciple, when we see that, as somebody who's following, being changed by, and committed to the mission of Jesus. And so to help you with that, what we invite you to do as a community is we invite you to live something called the intentional life of a disciple. So we especially challenge everyone in the church, but especially our partners and those who get baptized. And so the intentional life looks like this. We say you start with God time. Every day we want you to be in the Word of God in prayer at least 15 minutes. Gather, be a part of a church community like this. Gathering group. We grow most in a discipleship group when you have people challenging you around you. And then go time is you live in such a way that points people to Jesus, both with your testimony and the way you live. And so we invite you to live the intentional life of a disciple. That's what we do. That's what it means to be a part of this church. That's our discipleship pathway. And so the people getting baptized today, they're ready to make a commitment that I'm going to follow Jesus more closely. And it's a big deal. So if that's you, I want to ask you to come over here today and stand on the my right, your left, and we're going to begin doing these baptisms. And as they do, church, what I want you to do is I want you to cheer them on. So when they come out of the waters, well, yeah, right away. Come on over. Don't be shy. And when they come out of the waters, I just feel free to cheer for them after. I'm going to ask that you stay seated until all the baptisms are done. It'll be a song or two, and then we can just stand and praise the Lord. But join me in prayer as we cover these who are getting baptized today. So, Father, thank you for these brave souls who have made a commitment to go into the baptism waters, to say, I love you, Lord, enough to go public with this, to say it out loud, to do it in front of all of these people. And I'm going to follow you more closely. So, Lord, I just pray you draw them closer to you. You put it on their heart what it looks like to follow you. And Lord, you work in and through their lives so powerfully that others can't help but see it in their lives, Lord, that they point people to you through that and that you draw them into a closer relationship like never before, Lord. Thank you for what you've done in their hearts. Thank you for what you're going to do in the hearts of many who are even here today. And so, Lord, we honor you and glorify you as we celebrate this baptism in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Let's celebrate.
Let's enter back into worship. I searched the world, but it couldn't fail me. Man's empty praise, the treasures that fail are never enough. And you came along, put me back together. Desire now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better. To show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, Lord, you've seen them all. You still call me friend. You're the God of the mountain. He's the God of the valley. Your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing
turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the
every heart. I worship you.
promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are
way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
That is who.
That is who you are.
Age to age, he stands. great, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, how great. That we can come and declare that you are good and that you are great and greatly to be praised. Thank you for now letting us worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and take your seats this morning.
Amen. Well, I'm so proud of this church. You know, that last young man that was in the baptismal asked his youth pastor and his small group leader to join him in there and put him under the waters. I just think that's so cool. Because so here we go, 2,000 years later, Jesus said, go make disciples. And we see it happening right in front of us, alive and well at Christ the Rock Church. God is moving. I'm so proud of you. I love it. And that's possible because of you as a church. And so I just want to say thank you for all the ways that you support the ministry, the mission at Christ the Rock Church. God's got to be so pleased. We got 17 more next service. We see all these people get baptized here. And that's because not just your finances, but your time and your energy and your support. And you tell other people about what God's doing at Christ the Rock and other churches. Thank you, church. I just want to say how blessed we are. We've got what we need. God continues to provide our daily bread for us as a church and as individuals. And so we're going to I'm just going to pray for the offering. And as I do, I just want to say, though, again, I'm so proud and thank you for all the ways you've been generous with us as a church. Let's thank him for what he's doing. Father, we are so grateful. You're moving in the lives of young people, and you're moving in the lives of middle and older and all ages. You're bringing us closer to you, Father. And so thank you for who we saw get baptized. Thank you for who's getting baptized next service. Continue to work and move in our hearts. And we thank you for the generous people at this church that pour into the lives of other people with their time and their energy and their prayer. The prayer warriors we have at this church, the givers, all of the people who, Lord, you have brought to help your church, your name, be glorified throughout the earth so that many might come to know you. And so we just pray, Lord, as we continue to live this mission you've given us out, we see more people come to Jesus, more people get baptized, more people get discipled. Lord, thank you, Father, that you are moving and active and alive still in your church today. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is how Jesus says we ought to pray. We are in the third week of our series titled Teach Us to Pray. If you don't know me, my name is Ben. I'm one of the teaching pastors here, and I'm just so excited to be with you as we continue this series and excited about all the baptisms today. Can we give it up for those who got baptized one more time? Just praise God. He is moving in our church, and I'm so happy to be a part of that. And we are in this series that we're really like receiving a masterclass from Jesus himself on what it means to pray. His disciples said, teach us how to pray. And he said, this is how you ought to pray. So we're primarily looking at the Lord's Prayer throughout this series, but we'll also look at some other passages and some other tools and resources as well to help us develop a deeper prayer life individually, but also as a church. Now, as Pastor Joel explained last week, we're not looking at the Lord's Prayer like we have to pray these exact words every single time. I didn't grow up in a Christian home, so when I first became a believer, the first book of the Bible I read was Matthew. And I got to this part, Matthew 6, and he says, this is how you should pray. And I went, okay, I guess that's how we pray. So every day I'd only pray the Lord's Prayer, and then I'd be like, amen, I guess I'm done. And not that there's anything wrong with that necessarily, but what Pastor Joel told us last week is that this is more of a model of prayer, an invitation into certain ways that we get to pray. It's an incredible invitation and ways that Jesus is teaching us how we can pray. So last week we looked at Matthew 6:9, and we learned what it means to pray to God as our Father. And Pastor Joel also led us through what it means for us to pray and live our lives in such a way as to make the name of God holy. And so I encourage you to go back and listen to that message. It was an incredible message. But this week we look at the next part of the prayer. And it's a prayer that invites us to imagine a different world and to imagine different lives. And it's in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. And it says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, many people have prayed this prayer many times, but do we truly understand the power of this prayer? It is a powerful prayer. Do we actually think about the words we're saying when we pray this? Because this type of prayer ought to stoke our imagination. This is the kind of prayer where we're asking for spiritual innovation to come into a world that desperately needs it. This is a powerful prayer. But to understand this kind of prayer, we must understand one central idea that Jesus is giving us in this passage. We must understand what Jesus means when he says the word kingdom. What does he mean when he says that? See, that's how the prayer begins. God, we want your kingdom to come. Well, what does that mean? Well, to the Jewish people, who primarily would have been the ones that Jesus was talking to in this moment, the kingdom of God was a very particular idea. It was really the fulfillment of all of their hopes as a nation and as a people. The way they looked at the kingdom of God is similar to the way that we think about the American dream. It's like this ideal, and it's kind of all-encompassing to who we are and what we believe as people. And so to them, it was the fulfillment of everything that they believed. But why? Why was it that way? Well, at one point, Israel was arguably the most powerful kingdom on earth. Under King David and Solomon, it became the envy of the nations. Other kings and queens would travel to Israel and show respect and learn from these incredible kings. It was the kingdom of God on earth, a true theocracy. And it was all topped off with a magnificent temple on a hill where God chose to bring his presence. It was the place where heaven and earth met. That's what the temple was, the place where heaven and earth would meet. And God promised that there would be an everlasting throne and that this would be a kingdom with no end. And he kept that promise. But as the Israelites went on, they began to disobey God. And he said to them, he warned them multiple times, if you continue on in this way, you will be taken over by another nation. And they didn't listen. And God was true to his word. So a people called the Babylonians came and they conquered Israel. And they sent them into exile. Now during this time, as the people of Israel were dispersed around the world, they clung to one thing. The promise of a restored kingdom. A kingdom that would come and that Israel would once again return to its former glory. And during this exile, there was a prophet named Daniel. And he's the one who actually just painted a very vivid picture of what this kingdom to come would be like. In Daniel chapter 2, it says, in the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those other kingdoms, bring them to an end, but it will itself endure forever. And in Daniel 7, it says, in my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like the Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshiped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. So to the Jews, this was the fulfillment of the kingdom they were waiting for. They had this vision of a future kingdom that would take place and restore their former glory. And they knew that the one they were waiting for, the one who would usher in this kingdom, was someone they called the Messiah. Someone who would fulfill all these prophecies of the Old Testament and would bring about this kingdom. And so that's who they were waiting for so that they could see this kingdom come. And then a man named Jesus came along. And every time he would enter a village, he began by preaching one specific thing. It was the first thing he said every time he went into a village. In Mark 1, it says, after John was put into prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. So this is what Jesus would say every time he would enter into a village. And then he would go on to teach them what this kingdom was like. And he would demonstrate what this kingdom was like. Casting out demons and healing people and raising the dead. He was showing them that the kingdom had truly come. So this is what Jesus' ministry was all about. The kingdom. But again, we have to come back to that question. What did Jesus mean when he said the word kingdom? Well, the original word used here in the Greek for kingdom is basileia, meaning the realm and reign of a king. So the kingdom of God is wherever God rules and reigns, wherever his realm is. So this is what Jesus is saying. When we pray for God's kingdom to come, we will see God's will be done. You pray for God's kingdom to come, you're going to see God's will be done. Why? Because in a kingdom, a monarchy, a true monarchy, the will of the king is always done no matter what. That's how a monarchy works. We don't understand that. We live in a democratic republic. So we're just like, if there's some king, we don't have to listen to him. But what Jesus is saying is that wherever God's kingdom is, God's will is going to be done. Dallas Willard says it this way about God's kingdom. The kingdom of God is God reigning. It's present wherever what God wants done is done. It's the range of God's effective will. I'll say that one more time. It's God reigning. It's present wherever what God wants done is done. It is the range of God's effective will. So whenever and wherever God's will is being done, we know that the kingdom has come in that place and in that person's life. And how do we know that God's will is being done? Like, how do you know that? Well, it's the next part of the prayer. He says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So when God's will is being done, earth should begin to look more like heaven. That's the idea. Why? Well, because heaven is where God's realm exists. It's the place where he completely and fully rules over. So Jesus explained this to Pilate on the day of his crucifixion. What did Jesus say to Pilate when he said, so you're a king? He said, well, my kingdom is not of this world. My kingdom is not of this world. Meaning my kingdom right now is in heaven, but he's like, Pilate, you better watch out. So Jesus is saying that the kingdom prayer, it is a prayer of imagination. It's a prayer where we get to imagine a different world. But the kingdom prayer is also a prayer of invasion. We are praying for heaven to invade earth and have earth be different, to be more like heaven. And when we pray as it is in heaven, we're showing that heaven is the standard that we're shooting for. Heaven is superior. Earth is the subpar version, and heaven is the premium version. Every time we pray that prayer, we are acknowledging that that is the truth. So we should not want things to just be the way they are. We shouldn't be okay with the status quo. We should actually want earth and our own lives to look more and more and more like heaven. But how many of us know what heaven is truly like? We haven't been there. We struggle to really know, like we love the idea. Man, what an exciting idea, but what would that actually look like? And so we need to turn to the scriptures, God's word, that give us vivid descriptions of what heaven is like. And so I'm just gonna give you five scriptures that help us see a snapshot of what heaven is like. The word of God says in heaven, in Revelation 7, all people live and worship together as one. In Isaiah 55, no one goes hungry or poor. In 1 Corinthians 15, no one is sick. In Isaiah 2, there is no violence. And in Revelation 21, there is no death. So that's what heaven is like. Jesus is saying that when we pray, we should pray that earth would look more like this. That this is what earth should be more like. Okay, then how do we actually do that? How do we pray those kinds of prayers? What do those kind of prayers sound like and look like? Well, I don't want to tell you exactly how you need to pray, but I just want to give you a few ideas of what these kind of prayers can sound like, the kind of world that we can imagine when we pray this way. So I want to bring that list back up, and this time I'm going to include some prayers that are ideas of how we could pray these things. So praying for earth to look more like heaven. The first one, all people live and worship together as one. Pray for peace among people, groups, and nations. Pray for unity among churches. The next one, no one goes hungry or poor. Pray that homeless people will find homes. Pray that businesses create jobs and people find those jobs so that they have the means to be able to go and eat. No one is sick. Pray for the sick to be fully healed in the name of Jesus. Pray for hospitals to have more Christian doctors and staff. There is no violence. Pray for peace, even when war is justified. Even when it's justified, we can pray for peace. Pray for relational divisions and families to be healed. And there's no death. Pray that people put their faith in Christ so that they don't need to fear death. And then pray for overdose deaths and suicides to decrease in our area. Unfortunately, just this week, just this last week, we ran into the tragedy of two young people who took their own lives. One of them, their funeral was right here. And it's just a devastating thing when young people take their lives, no matter what age. And so we can actually pray. And when we see tragedy and brokenness in our world, we can go, God, what do I pray? We can pray for his kingdom to come and his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. We can pray this over our families. We can pray this over our schools. We can pray this over our workplaces. We can pray this over our cities and our towns and our nation. We can say, God, in my family as it is in heaven, in my school as it is in heaven, in my workplace as it is in heaven, in my city as it is in heaven, Lord, let it be so. Those are the kind of prayers that we can pray. And then the Bible, God's word, it actually takes us a step further. God brings us one step further beyond that. He actually says we should see ourselves as people who come from heaven. That's how much we should take this seriously. Look at how it says it in Philippians 3. But we are what? Citizens of heaven, where the Lord Jesus Christ lives, and we are eagerly waiting for him to return as our Savior. We are citizens of heaven. So we are to look at our primary citizenship as in heaven, and that America is just a country we happen to be living in. That our citizenship here is secondary to our citizenship in heaven, which means that we're ambassadors to this place because we come from heaven. So we're here to show people what heaven is like. We're here to pray those prayers. And Jesus knew this. He was from heaven. He knew that this wasn't his home, at least not until the age to come. And so the only thing he knew how to do was live like somebody from heaven. The only thing he knew how to do was to speak and talk and think like someone from heaven. So he walked into the brokenness in this world. He's like, well, that's broken. I'll fix that. I'll fix that. I'll fix that. Demon out, person healed, raise the dead. All right, let's go. Like, that's what Jesus was doing. He was living like someone from heaven. So I think that we should pray for earth to look more like heaven, but we also should be willing to be the answer to those prayers. We should be willing to step up. Sometimes we might pray those prayers, and I think God looks at us and says, great idea, now go do it. See, actually, it's Christians who over the last 2,000 years have made earth look more like heaven. There's so many things that we take for granted that we just assume are earthly ideas. The people have always done it that way, but it's not true. They're heavenly ideas. And it was disciples of Jesus who fought the hard fight of faith to bring those things into reality in this world. For example, there are many ideas that we believe are true in the Western world, that they've just always been true. But it was actually Christians who brought it about. So I'll take you back to England in the late 1700s and into the 1800s. We think of it as a Christian nation, but actually they were losing their empire at that time. Crime was on the rise as cities were industrializing. Poverty was rampant. Disease was pervasive. Religion was like, people weren't even worrying about that anymore. And things continued to go from bad to worse. But due to the work of Christians in England, things began to shift. Things began to change in the culture. I want you to see some things that Christians brought about. It was Christians who brought about the abolition of the slave trade in the British Empire. They brought about the establishment of many orphanages and hospitals and soup kitchens and other charities. They brought about the protection of workers' rights in dangerous factory conditions. They brought about a decline in crime and revolutionary activity that was rampant at that time. See, many things that we take for granted, that we think have just always been true in Western society, were not. Slavery had been around for thousands of years in cultures all around the world, and it was disciples of Jesus who brought it crashing down. The entire idea of charity was the work of Christians. Just think of Ebenezer Scrooge if you want to think about how did English people think about charity at that time. They thought, why would I take my hard-earned money and give it to someone who's poor? They didn't work hard enough. That was the idea, but Christians changed the narrative. They changed what that looked like. And it was Christians who changed the culture in England. And actually, there's many historians that say, had they not at that time, the British Empire would have most likely dissolved and fallen into chaos and ruin. It was Christians who saved their nation. At Christ the Rock, we have a vision to see that happen here. We have a vision to saturate this area of Wisconsin with so many disciples of Jesus who want to see God's kingdom come and his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that our area would literally become a different place. It makes me wonder, what evils lurk in our community that we could see come to an end? What societal problems could we help solve and we could step in and stop waiting for someone else, like the government or someone else to do it? No, we could step in and solve the problem. What would it look like if the church would rise up and address poverty and homelessness and many other issues that face our communities? What could happen if we did that? So we're praying for God's kingdom to come, and he answers that prayer by often working in and through us to bring about his kingdom into this world. That we have the opportunity that we get to be a part of making earth look more like heaven. That's what he's inviting us into. Of course, he doesn't need any of us, but often it seems that he actually wants to work in and through us rather than around us. It's a powerful, powerful thing that we get to join him in this prayer, but also in this work. And this is why in our church we have ministry to kids and students. We have ministry to those who need counseling, those who are in recovery, to those who are trapped in sexual addiction. We have ministry to those who are experiencing food insecurity and more. And you can find out more about that if you're saying, yeah, I want to find a place to serve. Go to our website or go to the link and talk to somebody and just find a place. Just try something out. We also partner with people in the community like Vita, World Relief, Jail Ministries, Life Promotions, and more. And these are all places where you could say, hey, what could I do? How could I help? Give them a call. Go on their website. Because here's what we believe. We believe that together, with all of us together in this church, with all the other believers in our community, with the power of the Holy Spirit and the willingness to be the answer to the prayers that we are praying, we can see God's kingdom come and his will be done in our area as it is in heaven. And that's a vision I can get excited about. See, we can see our area changed, but not just for us. For our kids and the generations that come, this would be a place where people know that the gospel is preached and that people know the Lord. So we can pray, Father, may your kingdom come and your will be done in our community as it is in heaven. But here's the thing. If we are to be those willing vessels through whom God can bring his kingdom, if we are willing to be the answer to that prayer to see God's kingdom come and his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, then it actually has to start in us. If we want to see his kingdom come on earth, then it must first happen in our own heart. That's where it's got to start. See, we need this to happen in us before we will see it happen around us. It has to happen in us before it's going to happen around us. See, we want to see our culture, we want to see our nation, we want to see our schools and our communities look different, right? We do. But the truth is, we desperately need the change to happen inside of us. That's where it begins. See, though we don't always see God's kingdom in its fullness in the world around us, the Bible tells us that we can actually experience the fullness of God's presence and his kingdom inside of us. That's where we can experience the fullness of who he is and his kingdom. But we must first be willing to allow God to have his way in our lives. So that's why we look at verses like Colossians 3:15. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Let him rule in your heart. Or in Ephesians 3, then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. Or Matthew 16, when Jesus said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. And then Luke 22, the prayer of Jesus, not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done. See, we must be willing to allow God to invade our lives. That way, you can actually be the place where God's kingdom lives inside of you. You can be the place where the temple of the Holy Spirit exists. You can be the place where heaven and earth meet. That when people encounter you, they encounter a place where heaven and earth is meeting at all times. They encounter a place where God's presence resides. They encounter a person who is living on earth as it is in heaven. This is exactly what those who got baptized today were declaring to all of us, that they want to live as people who are submitted to their King in all the ways of their lives. They're saying, I want a life where it's on earth as it is in heaven. That's the kind of life I want to live. That's the life of a disciple. So we must ask ourselves, do we have any corruption in our own heart? Is there any forgiveness, any sin that we haven't repented of? Where in your own life do you need God to rule over that area, to be the king over that area of your life? Because you're not doing such a great job with it. It's okay to admit it. It's okay to say, God, I think I need you to take over here. Where in your life do you need to see his will be done? Because you're discovering that your plans and your will are not so great. Where in your life do you need to see your life looking more like heaven? What if your heart had no evil in it? What if you had no fear in life? What if you actually had true and lasting peace in your life? What if things like rage and anxiety and depression didn't have such a grip on you? What if they didn't rule over your life the way that they did? How would your life be different if that was true? This is why I call this prayer a prayer of imagination. We get to pray literally, believing that God will do something here on earth, that on earth it doesn't make sense. That to someone who's from earth, they'd say, that doesn't make any sense. But in heaven, it's completely normal. In heaven, it's just the way it is. And so we get to pray that earth would actually look more like heaven and believe it to be true. Not just around us, but in us. And the Bible tells us God wants to do that more and more in our lives. How much more? Well, Ephesians tells us. Ephesians 3 says, now to him who is able to do immeasurably more. How big is that? I don't know. It's immeasurable. So it's that big. He wants to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, not around us, within us. So whatever you think would be just too crazy, oh, I just can't pray that prayer, that's too crazy, or it's just too off limits, or it's too big, like God just, he just doesn't answer prayers like that. What the Word of God tells us is actually, God will do immeasurably more than you could ever ask or imagine. Whatever you're praying, His will is way bigger and way better than whatever it is you can come up with in your prayers. Now, I'm not saying if you're like, oh, I need a new car, so God's going to give me a G-Wagon. All right, this is going to be awesome. No, what He really wants is He wants to bring heaven into your life. He wants to fill your life with heaven to the point of overflowing. He wants to bring so much beauty and growth and health and wisdom and peace and joy and love into your life that your life will become completely transformed, that you become a different person. That is what He's saying when He says, I want to fulfill that prayer in your life. And I think we all need that. We all need Him to transform our hearts and our lives. So much more than we could ever imagine. So much more than we could even measure. And so we can pray, Father, may Your kingdom come and Your will be done in my heart, in my life, as it is in heaven. That's a prayer we get to pray. Now, before we leave here today, I actually want to give you an opportunity to pray in that way. I want you to pray this way in your lives, but we have this moment together, and I don't want us to miss it. That as the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, maybe convicting you, encouraging you, leading you into something, that I give you a moment to actually pray this way. So I want you to think of the areas of your life that simply don't line up with God's will. The things that just don't look like heaven in your life. The things that are just tripping you up, that keep pulling you in the wrong direction. The areas where you need God to move more than anywhere. The areas where you need His kingdom to invade your life and transform your life. See, we're going to sing a song together in a moment. And in the lyrics of the song, it says, Father, let Your kingdom come. Let Your will be done. Here it is in heaven, or here it is in heaven, right here in my heart. And we would say, God, we want that to happen right here in my own heart. That's the prayer we need to pray. I want us to be praying the prayers that God's kingdom would happen in our world, that we would be the ones who'd be willing to work for that to happen. But it's got to start here. We've got to pray for His kingdom to come in our own heart before we're going to see it happen around us. And so I want to give us a moment to reflect on these things, and then to sing together and just as a prayer, a unified prayer together, to invite Him to do these things in our own hearts and lives. So I'm going to pray, and then I'll let Pastor Marcus lead us in a moment of reflection and song and prayer. And so let me pray as we end this time of being in God's Word together. Father, oh, Lord, we do pray that Your kingdom would come, that Your will would be done here in our lives and in our community and in our nation, in our world as it is in heaven. Lord, we look around the world, we see so many tragic things, so much darkness, and we sometimes wonder where You are. Lord, instead, may we respond with this prayer. May Your kingdom come and Your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. God, if there's any area in our own lives that's not lining up with heaven, not lining up with Your will, not lining up with Your ways and Your word, Lord, I pray that You would convict us, and I pray You'd lead us. Transform us, Holy Spirit, into the people that You want us to be. Help us to have Your kingdom just more and more take root in our own lives, and that we would see immeasurably more, all that we can ask or imagine taking place as we see Your power at work within us. And as that happens, Lord, may it overflow to the world around us as we see more and more people find hope in You. So God, we thank You that You've invited us to pray this way. And I pray this all in Your name, Jesus. Amen.
Father, let Your kingdom come. Father, let Your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let Your kingdom come. Father, let Your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart.
You know, as we go today, you know, I'm just sensing there are some of you here who just don't know the Lord. You don't know the peace of being a follower of Jesus, of just knowing that without a doubt, you'll be with him in eternity when you die. And I just want to invite you, if you've come here today and you're seeking answers and you just sense God's calling you to him, to know that your relationship with the Lord starts when you say, Lord, I need a Savior. I need you. And you say, I know there's things I've done in my past that I don't know what to do with, but I know I can bring them to you. And he died on the cross for your sins so that you might be forgiven. And so your first step of faith is just to come to the Lord and say, Lord, I need you. And I confess I'm a sinner and I can't solve it on my own. So I ask you into my life, into my heart today. And I want to be a follower of you. And I give my life to you. And if that's you today, I just want to invite you to consider coming up after and talking with one of us, or just praying that prayer in your own heart and saying, Lord, I need you. And I want to pray these prayers. I want to know they're heard by you. And if that's you today, I just want to invite you after, come on up. There's pastors always up here to pray and to talk with you and help you figure this out. And, you know, if you give your life to the Lord, and, you know, it says baptize, we'll drop you right in here. We can do it on the spot. We'll have fun with it, you know. And there won't be all these people to watch you, but it'll be great. So who knows? And if you want to connect with our church or, you know, learn a little more, you can come up here. There's a place called The Link out there. And you can check in and just see what we're about as a church. And so I thank you for all you're doing again. I'm just, again, so proud of this church. It's been a great celebration. Heard from the Word of God. Let's go out into this world and show people the love of Jesus as we go. Thank you, and we'll see you here next week as we continue in this series. Take care, everybody. Love you.